Good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome to the first meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our agenda item is to take evidence as part of our budget scrutiny of the culture spending portfolio for 23-24. This follows on from the committee's pre-budget scrutiny last year, and this morning we are joined in a round table by Alex Patterson, Chief Executive of Historic Environment Scotland, Ian Munro, Chief Executive of Creative Scotland, Donald Smith, Director of the Scottish International Storytelling Festival and Chair of the Programmers Group Festivals Edinburgh, Chris Sherrington, Policy and Strategy Support for Music Venues Trust, Moira Jeffrey, Director of the Scottish Contemporary Arts Network, and Sir John Layton, Director General of the National Galleries of Scotland. And thank you all for your attendance at committee this morning. Could I begin with a general question? In our pre-budget scrutiny report, we concluded that the sector now faces, and I quote, a perfect storm as it struggles to recover from COVID-19 pandemic, compounded by the cost of living crisis and following on from longer term budget pressures. What is your assessment of how the Scottish Budget for 23-24 has responded to this perfect storm, and how, if at all, has the outlook for the sector changed from the evidence that was presented to committee a couple of months ago? And if I could begin by inviting Ian Munro, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. So, from our perspective, I don't think the Scottish Government budget settlement for 23-24 has responded to that perfect storm that I was outlining to the committee. I think the risks to the future of the culture sector as we currently know and understand it have gone up enormously as a result of that budget decision to Creative Scotland. Now, we are in a position where we've somewhat unhappily, I have to say, stepped in with National Lottery reserves to offset that cut for 23-24 and avoid passing on the impact of those cuts in less than 3 months' time. But I think, given what we're seeing and hearing at the moment about the years ahead, if these cuts are sustained because the use of National Lottery reserves is a one-off for us, then we will have to be passing that on to the sector. And unfortunately, what that means is not a happy picture at all. I can give you some illustrations of that, but even under standstill, which is what we're going to achieve through the use of our National Lottery reserves in 23-24, it's still my estimate at the moment that a quarter to a third of the current 120 RFOs are at risk in the months ahead. And if these cuts endure into the years ahead, and we don't have the National Lottery reserves position to offset them, and we end up passing them on to the sector, it's my estimate that we will probably see no more than 60 organisations out of the 120 current RFOs funded. But as if that wasn't troubling enough, we have an expectation that there will be 250 to 300 organisations beyond that interested in multi-year funding, and they too would be unsuccessful in the way that the budget settlements look currently. So it's not a happy picture. I think that's an understatement. I think there's a lot of sort of unhappiness that exists about the implications of this, and I think it's on the back of the last 2-3 years where things have been tough enough because of the pandemic, but it's on the back of sustained standstill funding, which we've acknowledged for some time is not a sustainable position in and of itself, because in materially in this environment particularly, with inflation, energy costs and so on, you know, in real terms, that's probably looking like a cut of 20 to 30%. And that's before we've applied these hard kind of budget, the budget equation and the decisions that we would ultimately need to make on multi-year funding. So it's not a happy picture, as I say, and we will do our very best to try and keep things calm and stable in the funding offer that we've got in the in the year ahead, but in the years ahead, I think it's going to be even more difficult. And we are heavily reliant on our national lottery income stream to support the direct programmes for individual artists and for organisations that aren't in receipt of multi-year funding. But the pressures are going up exponentially as a result.
Thank you. I'm just going to come to everyone in turn for that. Ms Jeffrey, do you want to respond?
Yes, first of all, I'd just like to thank the committee for inviting us to give evidence today. I have 300 organisational and individual members across Scotland. I've met with many of them since the budget was announced, and it's so important for their voice to be heard here. We've already mentioned the perfect storm. This Creative Scotland cut has left my members without a lifeboat. There are 120 regularly funded organisations across Scotland, and as Ian has said, hundreds out with there looking for multi-year funding. That's 5,000 jobs within the RFO network alone. Those jobs are in places like Portree, Lumsden and Huntley in Aberdeenshire, places like Leibster and Caithness, and people are facing a really uncertain future because of these cuts. This is on the back, as we know, you know, as this committee knows well, of long-term standstill for the sector. My members are telling me that once these jobs are gone, they're not coming back.
Thank you. Mr. Smith?
Yes, so obviously festivals generally across the country share a lot of these pressures, including other things like the COVID hesitancy factor in terms of rebuilding audiences, a process that has, however, begun. The very low level of international tourism knocking on posts, which I know is affecting galleries and so forth, as well as festivals. I think that the angle I might add is that public support, while critical, is not the only factor in this crisis, and that a lot of us who are on the front line of this are now very much focused on how can we adapt to survive through this next period. I think that there is a very constructive dialogue begun with funders about maximum flexibility in the way existing funding is deployed, about focusing on what the key strengths of individual festivals, whether locally, nationally, internationally, are, rather than having a generalised kind of tick box where all funded organisations are expected to do A to Z. So it's a really tough picture. Festivals have taken a hammering, but we are hanging in and looking at how we can adapt and get through this.
Thank you. Mr. Sherrington?
Thank you. And also, I'd like to thank the committee for the chance to speak to you today. It's been great to come up and speak with a view to how the grassroots music sector is struggling at this moment in time. I think my colleagues will often talk about how and give a good picture as to how the public funding cuts are going to have a real impact upon that, and it's very disappointing for grassroots music venues who post-COVID and have received wonderful support through that and have started to looking at more public funding support are beginning to kind of emerge and look at that, and now they're faced with basically being told that there's not really much chance of them getting funding from that. I think the big concern from the budget for them though is that, unlike in England and Wales where they continue to receive support from business rates relief, is that in Scotland only 10 of the 84 grassroots music venues that we represent will be able to receive any rates relief at all, and there's a real concern that that produces a lack of competition against both Wales and England, which means that they will in the end end up putting up ticket prices, which they find difficult to do, and that for the money that they're looking at, they're going to have to increase the income that they're going to have to get in to cover those costs by over five times. This is a real concern for venues because they don't feel as though, with everything else that's going on and the cost of their energy costs that are going up as well, to have a fixed cost such as business rates being imposed on them, whereas their colleagues and compatriots in other countries are not having to face that, is a real concern for them. We do see that there is a real opportunity to start going out into the commercial sector and try and get investment from that, and we recognise that there is a need to increase on that, and so it's good to see things around the overnight levies. We would also look to encourage that there needs to be more investment from further up in the industry. High ticket price events have very little impact upon supporting grassroots music venues. And unlike in football or other areas where the Premiership teams all get to support the lower routes, that doesn't happen. And we would encourage the committee to look at options around ticket levies on the higher end ticket prices to support grassroots music venues. But the budget at the moment, unfortunately, I say mainly with the concern around business rates, really does put grassroots music venues in Scotland at a disadvantage compared to the rest of the UK.
Thank you. Sir John Layton.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you again this morning. The last time I appeared at the committee, I outlined a really very stark position for the National Galleries and for National Collections in general. And we talked about some of the generic issues which are faced right across the culture and arts sector, the lingering effects of COVID, the inflationary pressures, the loss of self-generated income, and so on. That's all very familiar to you. We also talked about some of the particular issues faced by collections of national importance, the high proportion of fixed and unavoidable costs when you're securing and caring for priceless world-class collections, the high costs of maintenance of the buildings and the state and infrastructure that goes along with that, all at a time when we're still all trying to rebuild audiences. So that was a very stark picture, and we faced, according to some of the projections that were in circulation at the time, a fairly massive deficit this year. So I can say that the draft budget recognises those particular pressures, certainly for the National Galleries, and I think also I can speak for the other two National Collections. I can see a way to balance a budget next year, which is a rather different picture from looking at a budget of a deficit of seven figures or 1.6 million, as we were projecting before. So that, in a sense, is something of a relief for us. I would say that the underlying structural issues that others have mentioned, they don't go away. And we will also have to work extremely hard to keep on building those streams of revenue and income. We'll have to hope for the fair winds in the recovery of audiences and the return of those audiences. And we'll have to keep on looking, as other organisations will, looking very hard at operating models and business models to see if we can maintain levels of ambition and access, but do that as effectively and efficiently as possible, particularly when the messaging that's coming through is that if you think this coming year is hard, then you better prepare yourself for much harder years to come in 2 or 3 years' time. So we take that messaging on board. But I speak to you this morning in a somewhat different position from the last time I was in front of the committee. So I would acknowledge that Scottish Government has recognised those the concerns that we laid out.
Thank you. And Mr. Patterson.
Thank you. Again, echo my colleagues. Thank you for the invitation to come and speak to you again. I think your question at the outset, convener, was, are the pressures still there? Yes. As I said the last time, the impact of COVID has not gone away, though clearly easing. And the cost of living challenges, or the general economic challenges, whether it's to do with utilities or inflation or other fixed costs, those things have not gone away either for us as an organisation or for the wider sector. That said, I would echo what Sir John said, and I would just acknowledge the support we've had from the Scottish Government through the budget process. We've ended up with a grant and aid settlement which is 5% less than the resource spending review suggested it might be, given the challenging budgetary environment in which the government is operating. And I said to the minister, I thanked him for a good settlement. And of course, you look at these things through different lenses. So I'm looking at it through the lens of historic environment in Scotland, and that's our view. Of course, I think it's important to say, when you're looking at our total budget for next year, that the grant and aid is one component part of it. and a major part of our income and our budget is the income that we generate through non-grant rate sources, so access to our sites, admission charges, membership, all the other commercial activities we generate. And the evidence we've seen this year is that the visitor economy has come back faster, stronger than we anticipated, and we foresee that continuing into 23-24. So when I add what we regard as a good settlement for the year from Scottish Government with what we see as opportunities from the commercial aspect of our business improving, then for the 23-24 year, we are in a better position than we thought we were going to be when we embarked on the budget setting process, which helps us do a number of things. Obviously, I said last time we were expecting a very significant increase in our utilities costs. We still are, maybe not quadrupling, as I said the last time, but certainly doubling, which is quite significant. I'm delighted my colleagues have got a very good pay settlement, but that adds to costs and so on. So we carry increased costs before we do anything, but with the budget, it will feed through into a number of areas where organisations and people across Scotland will see the benefits. So we will invest more in our estate, which is fundamental to our core business. And I fully expect we'll invest more in our grants programme, so other organisations will benefit from that as well. So to summarise, the challenges and the pressures are still there, but I think from a HES point of view, we thank the government for giving us a good settlement through grant and aid, and we can supplement that through what I hope are realistic estimates for commercial income as well.
Okay, thank you very much. And it was amiss of me not to thank you all for your previous written submissions to the budget process and the newer updated ones that have come in from organisations before today's session. Expect a bit of a free-flowing roundtable discussion. So if you do want to come in and answer a question, if it hasn't been directed at you by one of my members, please just grab either my eye or that of the clerks, and we'll try and ensure everyone gets in if they want to contribute. And I'm going to open with questions from the committee, and if I could invite Ms Boyack first, please.
Thanks very much, convener. And it is good to be able to follow up the discussions we had last year. I want to pick up on the opening comments that we had from Ian Munro from Creative Scotland, because I think your comments about the number of organisations you fund and the potential impact on budget cuts, because it's having cuts, but also with significantly rocketing costs. And it's looking at what the opportunities are, because we have raised things like percent for art and tourist visitor levy, but they seem a long time off, and social prescribing seems a long time off. So it's thinking about what do you think the solutions are now, because those organisations, and I think it was in the SCAN report as well, there's already been a hollowing out, and there's lots of artists and cultural workers have gone already. So what would your solution be in terms of advice for what we should say in our budget report?
So I think those ideas that you mentioned are of course ones that must be pursued, But what I would say is that I think they are supplementary to core culture budgets, which are the foundation or cornerstone of the business models of so many organisations. And it's from the confidence of those public funds that they can build their relationships and their other earned income and their sponsorship and philanthropic giving and so on. So I think at the very heart of this equation is a solid and confident public funding settlement that should be seen as investment. It's investment in those organisations for culture, but it's also the case that that investment translates into social impacts and economic impacts. And I think those wider impacts are what are also at stake here. When I mentioned earlier on the concern I've got that, with these cuts enduring, it will undermine that confidence in public investment in these organisations that will have a ripple effect negatively in the eyes of others. The size and the shape and the diversity and the reach of these organisations is what will, I would predict, if these cuts endure, will reduce enormously. And that means all that cultural, social and economic value contracts. Mm-hmm. So I think we can't lose sight of the fact that, these other ideas are definitely ones that are to be pursued, but they are longer in the medium to long term in terms of when they might even come on stream. And until you can get to that point without core public funding at the heart of the equation, you risk losing these organisations that offer so much anyway. So there'll be no sort of provision to the extent that, we currently see and understand at the moment. So it's self-defeating in that regard. But nonetheless, those ideas and the, work that's done in, terms of cross-portfolio, so health and education and so on, all of that is important, but it's supplementary to core culture budgets. I mean, the Moira mentioned earlier on the, jobs position, you know, of the 120 RFOs, that's 5,000 jobs, direct employment. But beyond that, it's also worth noting the millions of attendances to cultural venues that are associated with those 120 organisations, as well as the, I think it's 25,500 support opportunities for individual artists that are associated with all of those organisations. And that's just the regularly funded organisations. There are many hundreds of organisations beyond that that are similarly supporting individual artists, but also are assets in their individual communities right across the, geography of Scotland, but also working in very important areas that are in cross portfolio areas of health and education and so on, addressing matters of inclusion and diversity. So the wider ecology and network of organisations that we currently see, I think it's what is fundamentally at risk without sustained adequate levels of public funding from which they can build their other income streams. And what's also been mentioned today, of course, are audiences. And I think audiences, the pattern of audience behaviour is not yet a settled one post-pandemic, but it is the case that audience attendances are down, and of course in certain quarters, particularly for paid venues for performing arts, but not exclusively. But they bring with them not just ticket sales through purchase, income through purchase of ticket income and so on, but also bar catering, retail, and, also the wider visitor economy. So I think the, you know, the overall financial equation is has to be grounded in a confident culture budget settlement for the years ahead. And unfortunately, the way it's looking at the moment, I think there are significant risks to that. And I think we'll see a major reduction in all of that provision in the years ahead if there is no fundamental change.
Yeah, I think that's a really powerful warning to us. You know, it's a budget cut that's going to actually have real impact, because I think a lot of those venues have already started to dive into the reserves. So there isn't going to be any spare cash left for organisations to keep going, never mind invest in buildings. That's really powerful evidence. Kind of follow up, Moira Jeffrey, in your submission to us, you give us some really powerful case studies that cover those wider community benefits, cover the impact on the economy, and also talk about the loss of jobs. If we lose people from arts and culture, we don't get them back. Do you want to say a bit more about that?
Yes, a number of my members have provided case studies. If I could start with Deverham Projects and Huntley, Director Natalia Palumbo shared some information with me. In terms of impact on hospitality, business, education, the importance of core funding for culture is really evident in our small towns and villages. Deverham Projects gets less than £200,000 a year. I think it's about £110,000 a year. Has a team of six people. It supports approximately 50 artists a year. So that core investment from residents to facilitators, researchers, etc. Audiences from all over the UK come to more than 200 events a year in rural Huntley. This has an instant impact. The renting of property, staying in local B&Bs, people shop locally, they go to bars and restaurants, they contribute to local schools and initiatives. Devon Projects also has a key role to play in the town centre. Since 2019, they've taken over an empty property in the town. They've built this as a space for the local community and for an international creative community. It hosts events, it's incubated two community businesses since it's opened, and it provides free space for community groups and is available for commercial organisations to hire. Now, all of this has been built by artists and cultural workers from a tiny team with that core investment. It simply can't continue without that core investment. Another really helpful example to understand would be Atlas Arts. Atlas is based in Portree and works across Skye, Razie and Lough Alsh. They have income of £150,000 a year. And these are infinitesimal sums if we look at this across Scottish Government spend. This investment allows Atlas Arts to plan ahead. It supports four core jobs, but it also supports dozens of freelancers. Atlas has two boat-build cafes, a community boat race, a new Gaelic children's book, a Gaelic artist residency, two long-term artist commissions, and these are from Scottish artists, a library of community-made books, film screenings, and multiple partnerships across Skye, Razie and Lough Alsh. But I think what's really important to understand about this is how Atlas describes its mission. It describes itself as the connective tissue in this community, working in partnership with local charities, with local authorities. It's created apprenticeships, worked with local restaurants, huge investment in local Highlands and Islands freelancers. It creates jobs and training opportunities for young people that have a huge effect in this location. This is what we stand to lose. And this is on the basis that this is not coming back. The big question for me is I just don't understand the strategic position that leads us. These organisations are meeting the performance framework. They're meeting the outcomes the Scottish Government is asking of them in communities right across the country. And I really just cannot understand the strategic framework that would suggest that this kind of reduction in investment is sensible or appropriate for these communities.
Thanks. I was wondering if Donald, do you want to come in? Because in terms of festivals, you mentioned visitor hesitancy post-COVID, but there's also cost of living crisis. So have you thoughts about what we need to do more to actually enable festivals to be successful? We've already lost Film House and Belmont, which is impacting on the film festival.
Yeah, so I was going to just make the comment that we don't need to be predictive about all this. It's already happening. We've lost the Edinburgh International Film Festival and two venues, although I acknowledge that there's an adaptability and resourcefulness in our sector that is going to be absolutely critical, and I would acknowledge that funders and activists are struggling to find a formula to take forward a new model for a film festival. So, you know, it's that cycle of things. I hope that the committee, just acknowledging what both Ian and Moira have said, might urge the government that in the next funding round, our sector wouldn't be picked out for a reduction. One wonders pragmatically if the existence of these lottery reserves left in this budgetary round Creative Scotland a little bit exposed. I'm not sure what the background to all that is. But I hope that the committee, for all the reasons that have been outlined, would recognise that a positive settlement for the creative sector as a whole, including the festivals, and I don't think the festivals exist in isolation. They work with these organisations in localities, and they support creative artists, and they have strong connections with community networks, with the health sector, and of course with schools and education. So, and one of the things just to add that I think would be important to say as well, that I think over recent years, in a combination of policy development and grassroots activity and the way new multi-purpose arts organisations have developed and emerged, I think the contribution of this cultural sector has grown enormously to the objectives of Scottish society as expressed through Parliament, local government, and the government. The issue of local authorities is also pertinent here, because clearly local authorities are also under enormous pressure, and local authorities are another important backbone of investment in local and regional cultural venues of all kinds. I echo what others have said, and I'm really pleased that the National Collections and Historic Environment Scotland have received settlements that address the real crisis issues. I hope the committee would advocate that the broader cultural sector does deserve similar treatment as we move forward.
Is it possible to get just a sense from you, Chris, about what kind of money are we talking about in terms of business rates? There was only 10 organisations, I think you said, got support, but presumably this is not a massive amount of money. I suppose the challenge is, it goes back to your point there, Donald, about local authorities then have less income.
So currently looking at the information we've been able to gather from venues and also from the rates, it would be about £1 million annually minimum. So again, depending on views of it, it's either a lot of money or not. One of the big issues, as we mentioned, is that basically in England and in Wales, the retail, hospitality and leisure relief, which a lot of the grassroots music venues were able to receive, has not been carried on in Scotland, and it was initiated in England in 2018 as a thing that would carry on. It's been kept on as a temporary thing. Currently looking at the information we get, we would expect that across the venues that we look after, and I would say there are also additional venues as well on top of that, we're looking at about £1 million that would cover to cost that. Talking, you mentioned earlier about ways in which we are aware that local authorities are under pressure, and we are not saying that we want to take away that money from them, but it is, compared to the rest of the hospitality sector, venues in particular have extra costs on top of what hospitality would normally go through, as well as the usual bar and catering costs. There are the additional performance costs, which often they're having to supplement and invest into on many lost leading performances and things like that, which then goes on to develop the grassroots performances. For every £1.25 that we invest in two performances, we only receive £1 back, and from ticket costs, and the rest of that is coming from bar costs to cover that. So having these additional costs on top of that really is going to be a struggle for them. One thing I would say is that there are opportunities within the music sector which probably aren't available in other areas of culture. I mentioned about the ticket levies, and that is that at a grassroots level, the average ticket price is £10.90. Being able to make up those extra costs, the £1 million that we're looking at there from that, is really not possible, because we'd have to increase ticket prices quite substantially, which would then mean that people would not, when it comes to bookings, artists would not want to increase the ticket prices compared to other areas of the country in the UK. However, if we were to look at increasing the ticket price on, as I say, the further end, for arena shows and things like that, and looking at a ticket levy there, just the £1 increase on shows at the two arenas in Scotland would probably generate £1 million within the year, which would help offset the costs that we're looking at. So that's something that we would really look as a short-term solution, and something to be able to implement it quite quickly, is this idea of a pipeline investment fund, which would take money from the top end of the cultural ladder and invest it back into grassroots. And that's something that could be done. It doesn't necessarily have to be legislated. It could be done with kind of opportunities to push towards and influence the arenas and other larger contributors, because a £1 ticket levy there, the average ticket price is about £60 on that. Makes much less difference to the person that's buying it. And often there are already ticket levies in place for those particular arenas. If you buy a ticket for those kind of shows, you'll see that there is often a levy for the venues. We would just like to see that money being also used to invest back into grassroots music. I think there is an opportunity there. So that is one way in which we could look at covering that extra £1 million.
That's very helpful, because I don't think we've had that issue raised in the committee before. And I know there's issues about changing ticket prices as you get nearer an event. And some of you've mentioned £60. I've seen much, much bigger prices than that. So there's something about where does all that money go. That's been really helpful, I think, convener, because I think that stark issue about not enough money. It's been a long time when there hasn't been enough funding, but this year's going to be a crisis going forward. I appreciate that.
Sorry. We announced the Pipeline Investment Fund as an idea back in 2018, and it's been a really good way of getting industry to be able to invest back into it. Mm-hmm. This year, we've actually launched a fund which we administer through Music Venue Trust, which is giving out money to venues for them to take part in investment and development. Currently, it's limited to £5,000, but what I would say is that for a lot of those venues, £5,000 is a massive amount of difference, because it allows them to invest in production improvements, sound desks, and also staff training. Even in the 2-3 months that that's been open, we've seen over 100 applicants for it, and we've been able to distribute £120,000 already in that period of time. And that's money that we have managed to raise from national lottery events that we've run and have ticket income come back in. So there is actually a framework for there for that kind of ticket levy to be put in place and for it to start the investment straight back into venues directly.
Thanks.
Thank you. Dr. Allen, and then go to you.
Thank you. I suppose I'm returning to a familiar theme, Alec Patterson, but it's about one you mentioned yourself, and it's about the opening of the state. So obviously HES has had an uplift, but I appreciate it's one that's you needed, given the enormous estate that you have to maintain in difficult times and the lack of ticket revenue you've had. So can you say any more about what the plans are to move back to a model in more sites where tickets are being sold, and what the number of sites that are presently closed are?
Yeah, so I won't go over the whole high-level masonry, which we discussed the last time. So, I think what I would say is, firstly, inspections are progressing well. We've done over 30 inspections at sites across the country now, which is good, and we're doing them right through the winter because the weather's been quite conducive to that. So that the inspection programme is ahead of schedule and going well. Bear in mind that the whole rationale behind the high-level masonry project is health and safety. So, you know, we'll only improve access or open sites where we are comfortable that the health and safety concerns we had have been addressed. However, of the 70 sites that were in our concerned group, we've been able to open or improve access to over 30 of them thus far. Now, that doesn't mean they're all open, but it means we've improved access. So I was asking my team yesterday, since I was last here in the last week of September, you know, where have things improved? And just to give you a few examples, I mean, you might have seen we put out a press release this week to say that Dumbarton Castle will reopen, which is hugely important. I spent a day with politicians and with the stakeholders of Dumbarton in December talking about what we might do collectively, but the key there is opening the castle. So we'll get it open. I think we're suggesting around about March time. But that was a good example where we had an issue, a concern. We did the inspection. We found stuff that justified us taking the action that we took. Our teams on the ground were able to fix the problems that we identified, and we were able to say that we can reopen Dumbarton, Lochleven, Aberdour, Holyrood Abbey, Curross Abbey, St Andrew's Cathedral, and a number of others that we've said we're going to reopen as a result of the inspection programme. There are others where we've improved access. So if you go to Dirleton or you go to Dryburgh, access has been improved. And what that does in terms of income is that there are clearly some sites that we haven't benefited from the income over the last 12 months. When you look at our forecast commercial income, there are some assumptions in there. So, for example, Doune Castle, we opened it in June last year. St Andrew's Castle, we opened in August. We'll have those sites for the full year. But then there's other sites like Dumbarton and Aberdour and so on that we haven't had at all this year that we'll be able to bring on and contribute towards our income as well. So that's where we are. But to be assured, our focus and absolute priority is to get as many of our sites open as quickly as we can. So the inspection programme, and we've done a lot of our big sites. Some of the smaller sites will happen over the course of this year. Our priority is to get the sites open as fast as we can because we know that it has an impact with local communities and so on, but we can only do it when we're certain that the health and safety issues have been addressed. I can't sit here a year from now and say we've opened some sites because we thought they might be okay and actually we've had an issue. Health and safety drives us, but we are making really good progress, would be my thought to you.
Thank you.
Okay, go to Mr. Ruskell and then I come to Mr. Minto. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. I think some pretty sobering evidence this morning, so thank you for that. I wanted to ask you collectively about the policy that organisations have on reserves. Obviously, for Creative Scotland, there's quite a big impact for this year on your reserves. But in terms of wider reserves policy, does this budget, does some of the headwinds that the cultural sector is encountering mean that there needs to be a rethink around reserves policy? Are there particular demands on reserves beyond this budget that organisations are going to be facing going forward? So if I could maybe start with Ian and then we'll go around the table.
So for us as an organisation, I'll start with on reserves policy and then talk about sector organisations. For us as Creative Scotland public body, we've got that avenue of income beyond Scottish Government budget, which is National Lottery, which is has no annuality attached to it, which does mean that we can build up a reserves position. And that's a good practice thing for any business anyway, in terms of being able to maintain a reserves position. But we've been pursuing that for a variety of reasons anyway, much of which was actually about how we could use them to sustain the organisations through the headwinds of the perfect storm that we've talked about previously. Using our reserves to offset the government cut means that it's not available to be used for those other purposes. So actually, in a way, it's give with one hand, take with another. So I think there's good practice there for us to continue with that, but we're not allowed to build reserves in relation to Scottish Government funding because of the annual annuality point. What it means for organisations, though, I think it's worth recognising that we were really pleased to be able to negotiate and secure an enormous package of additional support measures from the Scottish Government during the period of the pandemic. So over 2 years, it was an extra £151 million in that period. It was fundamentally important to be able to sustain organisations through all the challenges of that period. But some of the later packages in particular enabled us to support organisations to build and strengthen their business models, including options to strengthen the reserves. Unfortunately, given the economic pressures that are part of that perfect storm, much of that has evaporated already. And I think we're not just in a position now of there being no financial resilience left in many parts of the sector, no fat left, as it were. I think we're now sort of hacking into the bone of that. But as many of these organisations are charities, the charities regulator, I'm sure, would be looking to organisations to have a reasonable reserves position. But I think much of it is gone. I think we are in a position now where the fragility that predated the pandemic is back tenfold because much of the good work that was done to help strengthen organisations during that period is now gone, as I say, and there is no opportunity to further tackle that. There are no financial safety nets in this current equation like there were during the period of the pandemic. So I think we will always want to encourage good business practice in the governance of all sector organisations, but their ability to secure that, I think, is deeply challenged in this current environment.
Okay. Warren?
Yes. My organisation, the members are reporting that they're using the reserves simply to meet their wages bills. So if we can take an example like the Fruit Market Gallery in Edinburgh, hugely successful gallery, audience figures gradually returning to near pre-pandemic levels, 96,000 visitors since April. They have really effective fundraising mechanisms, but rely also on funding from Creative Scotland at its core. That funding has been at standstill for well over a decade now. The cost of simply applying the living wage and its equivalent across their staff team of 53 people is £105,000. That's all coming from reserves. By the end of 24 to 25, they report that they expect to have used up all of their reserves on running the organisation. So this is the meeting the living wage. We're meeting increased costs in terms of artists' rates. And of course, for permanent salaried staff, there's an aspiration to meet benchmarks that everybody else would meet around the public sector pay deal. So this is simply to meet wages. This organisation has experienced a doubling in its energy costs. So the question of reserves is that reserves are disappearing fast.
So there's one or two kind of pragmatics around all this, thinking from the point of view of the frontline organisations and the kind of activists that keep the whole culture sector, particularly in its community aspects, going. So clearly there's a huge raft of cultural organisations and, of course, all the individual artists and creatives who operate as one-person businesses who have no reserves. That's simply not a relevant issue. You know, it's always a kind of slightly corporate question. And I would just flip that for a second. I'm also looking for the positives. You know, we've just finished the Year of Scotland Stories, which was one of the most successful of the themed years that we've had in Scotland. And the specific huge success was the Small Grants Programme, which drew on Scottish Government finance and on National Lottery funding. And a huge number of local community organisations benefited in the kind of report and evaluation as that is coming out, with the huge positive outcomes from a relatively modest investment. But that investment was in that sector of people who just are not operating on corporate models. And that is a lot of the grassroots energy in the arts. So that's where the public support programmes, wherever they come from, public sector, lottery, etc., are absolutely essential, because those people are just living from one project to another. On the organisational reserve, so Ian referred to that there. As organisations, most of us are charities, and we're under a cosh to have enough money in hand to fund closure, to meet redundancy costs and wind down. That's a kind of requirement of the charity sector. And I think that quite a number of organisations will be on the risky edge of not being in that position to meet statutory requirements. So that's the kind of very from the pragmatic, you know, front line. You need to hold on to enough money to wind down, which sounds a rather pessimistic kind of thing, but I think that's what people will be looking at. So it comes down to this thing I noticed in Scottish Government Culture Department seminar thing I was at, was a kind of line of thinking about what is essential to save. You know, is that where we're really at? What's going to go to the wall? And if that's the situation we're in, can we have some kind of strategy or review around that, about what's critical? Or is it just going to be a process of attrition whereby different organisations and venues will go to the wall, you know. We'll not kill them, but we'll not strive officiously to keep them alive, as it were, you know. So, I mean, that may sound a bit grim, but it's kind of, to a degree, some of the corporate discussion about collective investments are absolutely critical, but the actual pragmatic reality of running venues, festivals, organisations, whatever, those are really the issues now. Survival on what basis to get us through, as Sir John, I think, was referencing there. I don't think this is a one-off year, I think, we're facing. It's another question. I'd just like to put it in our mind, though, that I would like to air, you know, how the cultural thing as a whole contributes to the international standing of Scotland. That's not an issue that we've really sort of addressed, and the innovation and all of that, but we'll come back to that, just addressing Mr. Ruskell's question.
Yeah, I think... one of the major issues in the grassroots sector that we're looking at with our members is that actually the majority of them, although they act in a not-for-profit fashion, are not set up in a not-for-profit structure. This is mainly because of the fact that a lot of the venues are driven by initially a need in an area in a community, which is often driven by one or two people saying, well, we need to replicate this, we need to set up a venue, we need to do this. And for many of those places, they will set up as sole traders, or they'll set up in a limited fashion. And also because the fact we're often seen as hospitality venues, which do music, which is definitely not what they are, they often are set up in a commercial structure, and so therefore don't actually look at have that charity set up. We have been encouraging a lot of venues to transfer over to that thing, which would then involve them to look at reserves. The impact of that is that, as a result of that, many of them don't have reserve structures in place. Many of them were also ineligible for funding support during the pandemic, mainly because of the fact that it was aimed at limited companies and it was aimed at those kind of prerequisites, and we saw a massive issue with people not being able to, partnerships and sole traders not being able to receive funding through that. The other thing is, as I said, that many of them do operate in a not-for-profit thing, as much as they're not making profits, and also the rewards for the people involved are much lower than they would be. We found that when we asked venue operators what their average salary was in comparison to the rest of the arts sector, which is usually around, for venue managers, about £35,000. For most of them, it was £20,000. In fact, actually, the answer that we mainly got was, I haven't taken any money at all as salary. So reserves, it was interesting when during the pandemic, lots of venues were encouraged to receive funding and apply for funding. And for many of them, the question that was asked was, what are reserves? Because they were able to apply for reserves within that. And I would, further on to what Ian said, I would thank the government for their support during the pandemic. It was a wonderful strategy of support. Unfortunately, a lot of the venues were unable to receive some of it. And as I say, they're not living off reserves at the moment. They've never really had them, because they are often investing straight back into what they want to do. If they've got the question of, should I invest in a new sound system, or should I invest in the next artist, they will take that as that's where they should be focusing before they're putting reserves in place. And that's nothing against the business nuance of these people. It's just the idea that they've never had the excess money in the first place, and often have been unable to apply for public funding, which requires them to have reserve structures in place. We have seen an increase as there are tax breaks, and we're encouraging venues to take part in it. But that is also why, as a result, yes, why I mentioned about the business rates, is that unlike a lot of charities who work in the sector who are already receiving reliefs around business rates, things like that, most of these venues are not eligible for it. So, yeah, unfortunately, most of these venues have not had reserves, and any they did have were wiped out during the pandemic.
Thanks. That's really useful. Sir John?
Yeah, I do really just to echo what colleagues have said, that in a situation that the sector faces, reserves is not the answer. In business terms, it's very obvious that reserves are there for, if they exist at all, are for short-term crisis funding. And the issues we face are not short-term, they're long-term. And relation to the National Gallery of Scotland, as an NDPB, we don't tend to hold reserves or build reserves within the NDPB because of the annuality that Ian referred to. We do have the support of an independent charitable foundation into which philanthropic funds can go. Those tend to be used not as reserves, but to support longer-term projects that require multi-year funding, which is harder for because of the annuality of NDPB funding to do. We have also looked, is it possible in a Scottish context to look at something like an American model where you would build up an endowment fund? These are not reserves. This would be an endowment fund that would, the interest from which would help to relieve some of the funding pressures. But of course, the sums involved, the capital sums involved, are huge before you start to generate any income of that would be of interest. Endowment funds are exposed to the very risks across the economy that we're all familiar with. So I don't think it's something that we're going to be able to pursue with any great degree of success.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. To be very brief, I think I agree with what my colleagues have said. We know organisations in the heritage sector who are using reserves just to stay afloat or to try to stay afloat, and that's not the purpose of reserves. So I would concur with that. And you know, through our grants programme, it's one of the things we're trying to do is support organisations to be sustainable and resilient. And of course, they've got all their costs and other sort of pressures, just as any organisation has. So I think the issues of reserves is very significant on the fact that they're diminishing or not there. From a HES point of view, we are an NDPB. We are not allowed to carry or build reserves. So we have that same restriction. We also have a foundation into which some philanthropic funds are put and managed. But I think when I was here back in the end of September, I floated the idea that the business models of my organisation, of other NDPBs, maybe just need to be revisited, because the challenges of COVID would not have been offset by any reserves that we had built up. But the fact we're not able to, or to do other sort of things, then, you know, in a world where things have changed a lot, maybe there's some flexibilities around the NDPB model that would be worth considering. So that's, you know, we're discussing that with our minister and with our sponsor team. The only other thing I wanted to say, and you know, it is hard to find a solution to the challenges we've all discussed this morning that doesn't come down to money. That's the bottom line, given COVID and given the sort of the economic and the cost of living challenges everybody's facing. If you take a slightly longer term view, and I said this the last time, but I take every opportunity to say it, we have to think about what end of the telescope are we looking at culture and heritage through. If we look at it just as a very narrow part of what we all do and consume and enjoy, but you know, is always, you know, going to be quite squeezed for cash, that's one way of looking at it. But Moira's intervention a wee while ago was really powerful, and it's what I said the last time. If you look at the contribution that heritage and culture and historic environment and all those related elements contribute, museums and galleries, it's not just to the narrow definition of culture and heritage, it is to, you know, the economic development. You know, the historic environment sector contributed 4.4 billion to the economy in 2019, supported 68,000 FTE jobs. That's not small. And then Ian will have the numbers for the wider creative sector. You comment about well-being. An awful lot of what we do in our sector collectively is at the heart of communities, not just in Edinburgh, but in Kirkwall and Lerwick and Stornoway. It is geographic across the whole of Scotland. So I think seeing what we collectively do and those we represent do through the lens of economic development, the jobs we create, the skills we invest in, the community building that takes place, the contribution to net zero that it all makes, I think that's quite critical in actually being able to think, well, let's not look at it just from a narrow perspective, let's look at the wider contribution that we make. We reckon that we as an organisation contribute to all bar one of the national performance indicators. And the same could be applied to other organisations around the table.
Thank you.
Yeah. Ms. Minto.
Good afternoon, and thank you everyone for coming along this morning. I will reflect on what my colleague Mark Ruskell said, and I think I used it at the last session as well. This is incredibly sobering. Donald Smith, you must have read my notes. My first quote that I wrote down was from Sir John Layton when you came last year to give us evidence, and you described the role of the National Galleries and other cultural organisations within Scotland as being mini ambassadors for Scottish culture. So my question was going to be along the lines of how you see the impact of the current settlements impacting on the international standing of Scotland, but also closer to home with regards to Hess and the work that you do across Scotland and how you can ensure that the reopening of buildings involves communities and, as my colleague Alistair Allen talked about, was the timetable of that. But I'd be interested to hear, Donald Smith, since you raised it initially, about the international side of this.
Sure. So thank you for that. And I know the committee has considered this in other sessions, but in a post-Brexit world, the culture, and in its broadest sense, I also include heritage in culture, you know, that is an integral part of culture, I think has become critically important to Scotland's standing. And we can look at that in terms of, you know, intellectual or academic or cultural, but also that has the impact on tourism as well. And I think that one of the things that has to be remembered is that the culture sector, in its broadest sense, is a platform for innovation. So in my own festivals area, you know, we have literary festivals, we have the science festival, including Festivals Edinburgh. It is an arena of ideas and of innovation. And at the end of the day, one of the questions I think the committee has to keep asking itself and asking the government is, what kind of image, what kind of Scotland are we projecting internationally? So I would argue that has become more important than ever. And I know that it's in the thinking of the big organisations about that international aspect, but there is a resources issue around that. And, you know, we can't do Creative Europe, which to my mind was a bizarre decision. We can't do Erasmus. So there's a funding issue there where we've actually lost funding that we previously performed disproportionately well in Scottish terms. There's the whole trading and customs issue about, and visas about, you know, so you're all familiar with that. So, but this, the conclusion for that has been, this isn't the moment for Scotland in its international standing to let slip on culture, because I would say it's central to people's perceptions of Scotland institutionally, diplomatically, personally, in family terms. We just don't want to lose that strong position that I think we have had in those regards. And there are these extra challenges. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Donald. Moira, I know that the work that you do involves international artists as well, and the whole thing that Donald touched upon there, and also Alex, about the fact that you've got heritage, but you've also got culture that's moving forward. So again, from an international perspective, how are you going to be impacted?
So the greatest pleasure in the role that I have now, and in, you know, over 20 years previous career as a journalist writing about the visual arts in Scotland, is the incredible impact of Scottish visual artists and visual artists who've lived or trained in Scotland overseas. Artists from Scotland are known, you know, from New York to Beijing. And they're telling the story of Scotland. They're telling a story of modern, innovative Scotland. And they're telling often difficult stories, important stories. So one of the greatest joys of last year, for example, was attending the Venice Biennale, which is a huge international focus, the most important international forum for visual art. And to see the Scottish Barbadian artist Alberto Whittle, who's going to be showing at the National Galleries in April, showing in the context of her international peers and talking about many of the things that the Scottish Government is asking us to address every day around legacies, for example, of slavery and colonialism in Scotland. So having these really powerful, difficult conversations amongst international peers, this is the kind of Scotland that we want to be and that we need to be. The organisations that I've been talking about, even these on really tiny scales, like four people in Huntley are working internationally all the time. So, for example, at Devrin Arts, we're seeing artists from East Africa, for example, living and working in partnership in Huntley. A gallery like the Fruit Market I've already mentioned, constantly co-commissioning with international artists, building international partnerships. This is absolutely vital. Now, we really do know the impact of Brexit has been astonishingly severe. This is around the movement of goods. It's around the ability to export. It's around markets for small makers. It's around the costs of attending international art fairs and exhibitions. There is no significant initiative to replace any of this lost work. And you know, one of the things that we've called for some time through cross-sectoral bodies like Culture Counts is for an Office of International Exchange that could support this kind of working across the cultural sector. It is the absolute lifeblood of culture, is these international conversations. They're vital and they are really at this kind of moment in our history in Scotland, to lose this, it would be a critical failure.
Johnson's like, quoted you at the start of my question. I think you highlighted the fact that you can loan out pieces of work, I think you said, from Dumfries to Shetland, but you were concerned that that might be impacted as well.
Yes, I think both Donald and Moira have articulated the dangers and the risks extremely well. If there's one thing that Scotland wants to be known for across the world, it's for our culture, our heritage, our arts. It's in our DNA, a really rich, vibrant culture where, across all sectors, grassroots, local, regional, national, international. That's what we do. That's what we're really good at it. And why are we jeopardising that? Mm-hmm. And there is huge interest, as Moira has articulated so well, there's huge interest abroad in Scottish art, in Scottish culture. We work internationally to bring all kinds of visual arts abroad, whether it's the Old Masters or the Scottish historical, as well as the contemporary. And as you say, to use that phrase, yes, it is an ambassador, but it is also a platform for all kinds of interest, further interest and deeper interest in Scotland. Culture paves the way for other types of interest, whether it's economic or commercial. So I think it is extremely important. But I suppose, getting back to the nub of it, and I think the frustration that you're hearing and you've heard articulated by many people and in different hearings is that you're seeing the impact of what, if you turn the dial a little bit negatively, the huge impact that is having right across this sector. You've heard that very forcefully. But of course, the reverse is true, that if you turn that dial just a little bit the other way and invest, that too has a huge impact. One of the things that has concerned me in listening to sessions like this and the sessions that various roundtable discussions which have been organised to discuss crisis is that we're being sucked into a resonance that culture is somehow a problem, that culture is a problem to be solved. Well, it's not. Culture is the answer, it's the solution, it's an asset to be exploited. And two of the words that have been used already this morning are investment and confidence. And it doesn't require bold or radical decisions to turn that dial just a little bit. It's nothing bold or radical about that. It's sensible. It's a sensible decision to invest that little bit more to have that huge impact and to unlock those benefits across so many different areas of life. And that includes To get back to your question, the international working and the international standing, and what it does for us if we're seen to be proud, confident, bold, and investing in our cultural life. That's what it's about.
Okay, thank you. And Alex, go back to opening up. Or...
Yep. So, and just very quickly, an international one. I think we know that research was done again pre-COVID. Over half of the international visitors who come to Scotland have on their list of reasons to come visiting a cultural heritage venue or experience. So there's that important international dimension. And of course, when you look at how we market Scotland across the world, you know, cultural heritage is a fundamental part of it. So that's important. Flip side of it is, you know, the international visitors. You know, we've seen through our estate this year a big increase in international visitors coming by, particularly from North America, but elsewhere as well. Nothing from the Far East particularly, but so international works both ways. It attracts people here, and it's an important part of how Scotland positions itself in market. As it sells around the world. In terms of reopening sites and the involvement of communities, I'd say two things in response to that. One is that over the last 18 months or so, we've reshaped the organisation, and out on the ground, you'll now find regional heads for the north, the south, central and Edinburgh. We spent a lot of time coming up with those geographies, but they make sense. So we now have a figurehead who leads for us in each of these regions, but underneath each of these regions we've actually put in place visitor and community managers. And the community bit is really important because their role is to engage with the communities in which our sites are located. So that's an investment we've made in that engagement. But I think beyond that, one of the things that I've been doing, particularly around high-level masonry, is getting out and about and talking to partners and stakeholders. Where have I been? Linlithgow, Dunblane, following our last conversation, we've been up there, and I think that has moved on. Down in Dumfriesshire, in Dumbarton, East Lothian next week. And it's all about engaging with the local politicians and the local stakeholders to say, how can we work together? And if a site is reopening, like Dumbarton, that was great because we can talk about how we work together with the local authority, with the football club and so on, to make the whole offer better. Where it's at an earlier stage, like the Linlithgow, the conversation was, if we have access restrictions at the palace, how can we work together with the museum and others to make sure there's a joined up offer there? So there's a whole range of things we're trying to do, are doing at engaging local communities, including putting more investment into our teams to engage with those local communities. And I think the final thing I would just say is that it's not always just about where we've got sites or about the sites. So, for example, we've got a number of junior guide programmes that we support. And I think, was it yesterday, we announced a new learning programme around, you know, this is about a site, around Creative Clavrock, working with organisations down in the Dumfries area on a whole range of education, learning and engagement type activities. So a slightly long answer to your question, but the engagement with communities is a priority, will be a higher priority given the resource we've put into it, and particularly around about sites where we've got restrictions. Engaging, explaining and looking at opportunities with the local communities is absolutely what we're engaged in.
Thank you, and I'm looking forward to then going to, I think, three of the sites that there are in Argyll and Bute that Good. Are on the high maintenance.
Good.
Masonry maintenance. Thank you.
Mr. Shane, did you want to come in?
Yes, to answer the question regarding the importance of ambassadors, if that's all right, and following from that, if that's okay. I think one of the things I just want to reiterate and following from Sir John's point is the exponential effect that the investment can have, and that some of the, you talk about ambassadors being advertisements for people to come to Scotland and people to invest in it. Artists are the best ambassadors for that. They mainly because of the fact that they have the opportunity to reach places that any of your advertising campaigns about Visit Scotland or any cannot reach. They will be on international TV programmes and they will be ambassadors across the world. They're also very vocal and can be both positive and negative at points. But I do think that it's important that showing the support to them and showing the investment in that can have such a massive effect. A small investment, you look at some of the current artists that are currently from the music world that are out there, and whether or not they're vocal or not. I look at artists like Lewis Capaldi, who has got reach on a massive international basis, and being able to get that message out there that art is important and Scotland is amazingly important. And also, we know that there is a lot of international tourism that is based around music and art, and that is bringing people to this country. But it's more than that. It is also the fact that these people are, you know, proponents for how wonderful Scotland is for Scottish culture and for Scottish life, and bring further investment into the country. And that actually, that's done at a very low cost to Scottish Government. If, as I mentioned, the advertising budget for tourism is quite large and is a very important part of it. But the small investments in artists like that and the organisations that support them and create them is amazingly important and can have a much bigger exponential effect. That is very hard to quantify, I think, is the most difficult thing for it. We can't really say what the benefit of that is. But one of the biggest concerns is that we see that although there is a lot of talk about how wonderful and amazing culture is in Scotland, is that it feels as though the Scottish Government is almost penalising it compared to other countries. There is a lower spend compared to many European countries and also across the UK as well. And it's important that in order to get those ambassadors and to have them to have a positive conversation about Scotland, we do need to invest in that.
Thank you. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. I've got two sort of areas of questions. The first is principally for Mr. Paterson and Sir John, who have both spoken about a more positive budgetary position than expected. And I suppose my question is, given that more positive picture, what do you see that enabling you to do? Do you see it enabling you to open more sites if you're HVS, perhaps reverse the closure of the Modern 2 gallery, turn the dial a little, invest, expand, whatever it might be? Or is it more a case of just, you know, I suppose, battening down the hatches and I think you spoke, Sir John, of a balance, being able to balance your budget. I'm just quite keen to understand where the additional funding goes. And I'll start with Sir John and then turn to Mr. Paterson.
Mm-hmm. So it's, thank you, it's a very good question. It's very much the latter in that it's, I would describe it as it's a potential year-long breathing space. As I said at the beginning, instead of having to somehow deal with a huge deficit, I can now see a way to balance. But of course, as we've also talked about at this committee, organisations like the National Collections, like Historic Environment Scotland, have to think across many years. We develop skills, knowledge, expertise that has to be nurtured across years. We have programmes and projects that have to be nurtured across many years. So short-term funding cycles are very difficult to manage. So I think the short answer to your question is that it allows us time to see how patterns of visitor behaviour will they settle on. Certainly, there has been an increase last year. Will that continue? We were about, on average, around about 70%, 75% of pre-COVID levels. Will that continue with the associated income? It allows us also to look at other operating models, levels of activity, levels of programme, and see other things that we need to perhaps stop doing in the in future years, or do in different ways, or do in partnership, etc. So I would say it's a breathing space, without really a perspective of what happens 24, 25, 25, 26. It's very hard to predict, but the messaging that we're getting is prepare for harder times. And so that's what we'll be doing.
And just before I turn to Mr. Paterson, I take it you haven't changed your view on multi-year funding, which you expressed to the committee in September.
Yeah, highly desirable, but not in sight at the moment, as far as I can see. And I can appreciate the difficulties, the uncertainties that government has to deal with. And I know that the Cabinet Secretary expressed the desire, the strong desire to do it. You know, we're in the position of now having a budget which will be finalised shortly for a financial year that begins at the 1st of April. That's, you know, it's harder to imagine shorter-term cycles of funding.
I'm sorry, if I could just pick up on your point about Modern 2. The closure of Modern 2 was always temporary, and this draft budget, if approved, would indeed allow us to reopen Modern 2 and hope to make an announcement about that very soon.
I'm very pleased to hear that. Ms. Patterson.
I would echo Sir John's comments about multi-year budgeting. I mean, the reality is that, as John said, we commit budgets over multiple years because a lot of the projects we do, a lot of the organisations we support through grants are multi-year commitments. Even if we don't know what our budget is, we're making commitments. So the more visibility you have in terms of multi-year funding, the better. The resource spending review, the capital spending review earlier this year or last year was helpful in giving some indicative figures, but that makes sense. A couple of other comments in relation to your question. One, yes, I did say that we are pleased with the settlement we got through Grant and Aid. Of course, the flip side is we carry a risk on the commercial side of things, but if we can realise the commercial income alongside the grant and aid, then I think a few things are possible. And I caveat all of this by saying our board hasn't yet met to agree how we allocate our budget. But I think there are two or three things I would say. One is, you know, it allows us to continue with the vast array of things we do. And most people associate us with castles and standing stones and so on, but we're a regulator and we do a whole range of other sort of learning and outreach and other sort of activities as well. So it allows us to continue with a lot of the things we've got in train. But I guess what might we be able to do over and above that, and I think I would just say three things. One, bear in mind that we all carry increased costs. So the pay award, which I'm delighted we were able to put in place, added an extra couple of million over what we anticipated based on the pay policy this time last year. Our energy costs will probably go up by 88% was the figure my Director of Finance gave me yesterday. So we need to increase income to cover the costs, but we will be looking to make additional investments into our estate. That's into the fabric of the estate, that's into the visitor experience, the visitor infrastructure at our estate, because that's fundamental. And linked to that is the investment in decarbonising the estate, the climate agenda, which is really important to us. And the final element where I think we'll probably put more funds into is into our grants programme. We reluctantly reduced the grants programme through COVID, because grants is a component part of our overall funding when that took a major hit. We actually maintained grants at a very high level, but we had to reduce them. So our aspiration would be to get our grants programme back to pre-COVID level. So those are probably, you know, assuming we can make all the top-level income work, particularly on the commercial side of things, continuing with the range of activity, but probably prioritising more into our estate, trying to enhance the grants programme and covering the fixed costs that are increased before we turn the key in a lock anywhere.
Thank you for those answers. My second area of questions is to return to the points made at the very start of the session, principally by Ian and Moira, and that is, you know, to address the cuts that are being implemented. I think it's of 10% to Creative Scotland, around £7 million. And Ian, you spoke about, I think, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but you spoke about it at a standstill level, that puts a quarter of your RFOs at risk. And that if these cuts were to endure, I think you suggested around about half of your RFOs would possibly be in grave danger. And I suppose what I'm interested in is what conversations are you having with your RFOs and the organisations that many of you here represent? What anxieties are they telling you that you feel you should perhaps pass on to us?
So, excuse me, your understanding is correct. So even on standstill, just because of the cost pressures, it's not actually standstill funding, it's a material cut. And our estimate is that that's between 20 and 30% in real terms, which is why at least a quarter, up to a third potentially, of the current 120 RFOs are in... or are at risk in the immediate months ahead, should nothing else change. And that standstill
and we've achieved standstill by backfilling the government cut through national lottery reserves as a one-off. Without those national lottery reserves, on the basis that those cuts endure, you're right, I think the, you know, there's a risk to half of the current RFOs as a minimum, but there are many more hundreds of organisations beyond that are seeking multi-year funding that they also want to make a case and rightly should be given the opportunity to, but we won't have the budget to respond. So there's no commitment to anybody beyond 23-24 at the moment, as far as the RFO is concerned. And long-term planning on multi-year budgets is a fundamental point. I think so people have worked really, really hard over recent years, particularly through the pandemic, to sustain their operations, their activities, their programmes that touch the lives of so many people in different communities across the country. They're in many ways exhausted, but what I think I'm hearing is despondency and disaffection with the very clear public statements of support by the Scottish Government of the extent to which culture and creativity are valued in the country, and the stark reality compared with how that is translating into the budgets. They are worried about the future, but they are, as Donald mentioned earlier on, are inventive. And to pick up with John's point a wee while ago, The extent to which, I've said before, our budget is 0.1% of the Scottish Government budget. It's tiny in terms of the value that it ultimately delivers. Disinvesting in that leads to a lack of confidence. That lack of confidence sees the risks that I've talked about in terms of the reductions to the sector, but it also sort of holds below the kind of waterline, the engine of creativity that comes from art and artists into the future, that would see the cultural sector thrive. So I think shifting the dial, like John was talking about, in the opposite direction is not enormous amounts of money in terms of the overall Scottish Government budgets. And I absolutely accept that there are finite resources, but the value that's already delivered and that now at risk could be reversed with an adjustment in the opposite direction that would unlock confidence, that would unlock in an exponential way so many different benefits culturally and socially, as well as economically. So it feels like we're about to go beyond the tipping point. And when much of this reduction that I'm talking about, were that to take place, it could be irretrievable. So I think there's an awful lot at stake here in terms of the realities of what are, yes, significant sums of money, but relative to the whole, small, and with just some adjustments could unlock an enormous return on that, and that would bring confidence back, the inventiveness and the innovation would come back, and it would ensure that we've got a thriving cultural sector. And one final point, if I can connect it back to the international point, it's fundamentally important, the international point, I think, is why we've put it in, and it remains as one of our four priority areas. It's part of creating the conditions for a thriving culture in Scotland. We don't get any direct resourcing from the Scottish Government for this, by the way, but the news of our cut, when it broke before Christmas, since then I've had many of my international network contact me with astonishment about the implications of that. Actually, they understand immediately, and it's partly because we have such a strong an internationally confident reputation. And that too is at risk in this current financial equation.
Thank you very much. Moira, would you like to?
Thanks. Really to follow on from what Ian has said when he's talking in those numbers about potential loss, then those anxieties are simply existential. And I think really to follow on around this question about sort of international benchmarks and also the kind of scale of cultural funding and government spend, the kind of ability to kind of wreak havoc but reap very little reward from these cuts, that strategically that doesn't make sense to me. Beyond that, I guess the anxieties that my members are showing is beyond this group of RFOs, those organisations who are waiting in the wings, who've been building up their skills and resources and who are ready to step up to the next level. The pipeline for future employment and particular huge concern for young people. And at the core of all of this, artists. We're nothing without our artists as a sector. That's what we're here for. We surveyed our members in the autumn around the cost crisis, and this is not just about, this is pre the announcement of the budget cut. And the impact of the cost crisis, one quarter of artists and freelancers who responded had already been forced to seek additional work. And 40% told us that if help wasn't coming, they would seek work outside the culture sector. So these anxieties are huge, but to reiterate what Sir John has said, easily fixable. These are not huge amounts of money in order to invest and support appropriately. We can do this.
I don't know if Chris or Donald wants to come in. Chris?
I just wanted, if possible, to give an idea of a case study just to support this, which is that as a charity, Music Venue Trust have identified one of the key issues that we have with venues is infrastructure, and that actually 93% of all venues are owned by commercial landlords, the actual physical bricks and mortar. As a result of that, we had installed a programme called Own Our Venues, which is an investment opportunity for anyone through community benefit shares to invest and raise money to buy these properties so that we can then offer fair rents and basically stop money that is going to commercial landlords to be reinvested into the sector. The reason I raise this is because the fact that when we've looked at this in England and had conversations with DCMS and Arts Council have been able to supply investment, they've just invested £500,000 into this scheme, which was the core bit of it, was to raise £3.5 million. And similarly, again, we've been able to have conversations with Creative Wales as a result of that, and they're looking to invest in it. One of my key things was to have conversations with Creative Scotland to be able to do this, but we are very much aware that from the conversations that we've seen before and from the conversations of today, is that it's very difficult to go to someone, a funding body, with a new development plan like that and say, this is a solution, because the fact that they're there with cuts like this, they're in a point where they're going, well, that's lovely, we'd love to do that, but we're having to really focus on making sure that what we're doing at the moment is available. And so we're really aware of him having those discussions. What I would say is that a project like that, when we announced the £500,000 investment from Arts Council England, then meant that all of the investors who had previously invested in it and new investors came in and went, well, we'll invest with that. And this is one of the things is that funding isn't just there to do things by itself, but it encourages other investment. And that's one of the key things. And that brings further investment into the countries, into the infrastructure. And as I say, from a case study for ourselves, we have great concern about whether or not we could go to Creative Scotland and or to the government and say, well, we'd like you to invest in this project, just because the message at the moment is, well, we're making cuts. And I think it's important that that is reversed. And as both John and Ian said, it's only a small change the other way to make these organisations be able to say, no, we want to take risks, we want to improve, we want to make things better for artists across the country. And just reiterate on what Moira said, this is a culture and an area, a sector, where it's not easy to replace people. And that's at all levels, whether it's organisations at the high level where people have been invested and have had a big background and worked in the structure for 30-odd years. We've just gone through a pandemic where people have started to had to move to other areas. To come out of that and then be told that funding is going to be cut, that actually the investment, and whether it's funding, as I say, or just investment in general in culture, that there's a view that that is not important, really is kind of the straw that breaks the camel's back and makes people want to move to other areas. And unlike other industries, they are not replaced easily at all. And we need to inspire more people to want to work in this area, and to be told that it's not important from a funding point of view just makes people go, well, I'll go and get a job elsewhere. So, that was just a case study from what we're looking at.
Thank you. I found the various case studies that have been mentioned today really, really helpful. Can I finally turn to Donald? Do you want to add anything to...
Thank you, Mr. Cameron. Yeah, so I run an RFO. I'm a case study. and we have an international festival, we have a venue, and we have projects and networks running in every local authority in Scotland. So you then sit and how are we going to get through the next year? And our two biggest areas of expenditure are staff and direct support to artists and local creative groups. Those are the two big. We also are trying to look how can we maximise things like other sources of project funding. So we've benefited from the Culture Collective programme, which has been another success story in culture, investing directly in locally led community projects, and that's Scottish Government money that hasn't come from the culture budget from elsewhere, as far as I understand it. So we will keep trying to keep that local support model going. We will have to lose staff. That's the only way to get through this. And I suppose that the worry and looking ahead in that is how do you recruit and attract? And Moira's point about young, the next generations of staff, the next generations of artists, if there's a kind of sort of hand of doom atmosphere brooding over the whole damn thing, you know, and that we're just a wee bit in danger of slipping into that at the moment. So I shift the dial seems to me the catchphrase of this session. and we need a positive trajectory. So we are adaptable, we are resourceful, but to create the future that we want for our society, not for some, you know, removed arts thing, for our society, for Scotland, we need to have a positive trajectory. At the moment, I can't see it.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Dr. Allen.
Thank you very much. I think just listening to this, and I think it's fair to see you have a sympathetic audience in this committee about the fact that you need, as you've just said, a positive trajectory in terms of funding. I suppose the only rider to that would be, and it's not meant to take away from anything you've said, that the Scottish Government could probably do with a positive trajectory too, and probably some notice or say over what its income is. But I think everything you've said rings true, and I suppose where it leaves us, given those constraints, is cross-portfolio working. And I know this committee's asked about this many, many times, not just to the culture sector, but to other parts of government as well. And this is one for everyone to chip in on, really. How do we make this thing that we talk about all the time real cross-portfolio working? We've often talked in this committee about things like social prescribing, cultural prescribing, but Ian, you quite rightly pointed out this is, I think it's supplementary to your budget to be doing this. The problem is that the health boards tell us it's also supplementary to their budget. I don't know what the answer is, but I genuinely would be keen to hear from people how we make this a reality, because we've talked about it many times. It's clear from the pilot studies that have been done around the country that the health service and society more generally could save money, could be healthier and happier if we were doing more of this. But how in these difficult circumstances do we do it?
Yeah, thank you. It is an important ongoing concern to make sure that we can unlock all of those opportunities. They are already in existence in certain quarters, and I think we should recognise that. It's just how they become embedded more fulsomely across the kind of public sector landscape. So we're not coming from a standing start. All the evidence is there about the effectiveness of this work. My view on this is that I do engage in cross-portfolio conversations. I'm sure they're happening, like the Cabinet Secretary has also said. But ultimately,
we can embark on negotiations, but everybody is in the same constrained environment and becomes protective of their own agenda. So it actually takes more radical thinking to go beyond that to understand how you can unlock those opportunities. And I think ultimately this can only be unlocked through political direction at the highest level and agreements achieved at cabinet level about pursuing those opportunities. As I say, we're all very committed to enabling cross-portfolio conversations to happen, but at the moment they're happening in a very slow burn and aren't going to release resources in the short term. But they have an important role to play in terms of the makeup of the value that the work of the culture sector does. So I think ultimately stronger political leadership to unblock some of the challenges in those negotiations would ultimately determine it. And if I can give you one illustration of this, which is Screen Scotland, that has become an enormous success story. Even in these challenging times, yes, there's a kind of fortunate set of conditions around streaming platforms and so on, but ultimately Screen Scotland came about through a combination of political will and determination to make it happen with the right people in Creative Scotland and Screen Scotland, with all the expertise that they've got being brought to bear, with modest pounds. You know, it was less than £10 million which has been applied in alongside our National Lottery funding for Screen to unlock that opportunity. It's already, as per the published data last year, a £500 million industry in Scotland. With a view to increasing that by 2030 to double that. So the combination of the three P's, political will and determination, the right people, and modest pounds, has unlocked an enormous opportunity there. And I can see that writ large across all other parts of the culture sector in the right conditions. So I think ultimately, political leadership is going to be a key part of what unblocks this.
As I say, that was for anyone to chip in on. That's what these round tables are really for. So does anyone else have a view on that, Alec?
Add another P to Ian's three just in a second. I think we've talked about mainstreaming a lot, you know, over many years, and I'm not sure it gets much beyond the talking. I think that's part of the challenge. And we all submit information as part of our reporting to government, business cases to government, around the key themes of climate change, child poverty, and so on. What I don't think we can see the connection is how does all this bringing together of what we all do around key themes, how does it feed through into the budgeting process? Because I think that seems to me to be the same sort of budgeting process we've had for an awful long time. So I've got three suggestions. One is a particular thing for the historic environment sector, which is we will have a new strategy for the historic environment sector, ideally in April of this year. And one of the things we've tried to do as we've done the consultation on it is make sure that we speak to lots of people out with what might be normally defined as the historic environment sector. Because if we're going to grow the sector, it does need the economic development agencies and the skills agencies and the funding council and others to come together. So I think there's maybe an opportunity around the new strategy. And I would say actually underneath the current strategy, some of the working groups have actually been quite good at bringing together lots of different interests well beyond the sector to work on key things such as skills and climate and so on. I think my second suggestion is, as new structures are put in place, and I think at the moment I'm not as close to it as I used to be, but I think there are proposals for new regional economic structures to be put in place. The sectors that we represent should be round the table in these new structures so that we're not a bolt-on or an afterthought for all the reasons that we've all talked about, the contribution we make to lots of agendas out with our narrow one, if you like. I think making sure that we're at all these tables. A new tourism industry group was set up recently. You know, one of my directors is on it, but it took some effort to get the operator of the biggest tourist attractions in Scotland to be on the National Tourism Leadership Group. So I think ensuring that we are around the right tables, particularly regional economic structures that have been set up, is good. But my additional P to add to Ian's is we almost need to stop. Sorry, we don't need to stop. We need to continue advocating for the mainstreaming and how do we get cross-portfolio working. But I think we need to do some pilots and pick maybe some geographic areas or pick one or two other sort of ways of defining pilots and say, well, can we do it? We had one property that we were looking at recently where social prescribing, the community engagement, all those things were potentially coming together into a project. And there are others out there that could be done. And I think is we need to do something. We need to run two or three pilots and see how it works and what it looks like and learn from them. And that might take away maybe the, sort of the high hurdle that I think is often perceived about how do you mainstream culture and heritage into all the other sort of things, demonstrate how it actually happens on the ground. And I think there's a few good communities around Scotland where we could do that.
No, I just to come in, but I see Chris has his hand up.
Yeah. I think it's key what Sir John said earlier, that we need to look at culture as an opportunity. This is not a problem when we're talking about funding that needs to be done, and it is a solution to so many problems that across the country and across many different strategies and portfolios. I think there does need to be more of the fact that we need to be in conversations with other areas, whether it's education, whether it's healthcare, and there needs to be more representation from groups represented here today at those committee meetings as well. I think that's a really key and important part of it. I think one of the key things at the moment that we can focus on is education, because there's a real benefit there that can be brought into it. One of the things that I was most heartened at the cross-party meeting group last thing was the sheer amount of music education that goes on and the availability of that to youngsters across it. But I think one of the key challenges is that it's viewed more as a pastime or a hobby. And there's not a lot of around career development of getting people from taking what artistic performances are, but also to look at the other areas of things around crew, around promoters, around running organisations and setting them up. And there is not a lot of education that's done around that. And there is also not a lot of career development that's put in place through. And we find that most people that are involved in the arts at that level, particularly at a grassroots level, haven't got a business background, they have an artistic background or are involved and often fall into actually the business side of arts. And I do think there needs to be more conversations between culture and education, particularly as to how that can benefit it. And also the fact that a lot of these people are doing portfolio careers does mean that actually what we tend to find is that in the real world, people are working in multiple areas. I know a number of people who are working in the arts, but are also working in education, particularly in healthcare. And I think that thing of working at a local level, enabling that kind of networking at a local level as well, is really important. We often find a challenge is that at local government levels, getting creatives involved in other areas such as education, to be fair, even getting them involved in talking to local government about culture is very difficult. But we do think there should be more regional networks, which then can have an impact on education in the city. My background is as a venue owner in York, and we soon found that being able to get into those conversations at a local level and have venue owners and organisations and arts organisations talking to local government meant that actually they were able to say, well, actually, we've got a problem in education where we want to involve children in, we need spaces or we need... And it's suddenly getting people involved at that level with local government means that those councillors and people involved at local government can say, well, actually, we have problems in this area. Maybe these other sectors can be involved and help provide solutions. So I think it's something that needs to look at regional and local government as well. And I think that's going to be a key thing, because that's where, as we mentioned, Don mentioned earlier, a lot of arts investments and also other investment actually happens. So more facilitation of regional networking for culture and cultural hubs is really important.
Just before I move on, we had actually hosted the Scottish Youth Film Foundation here last night, which started in Armadale, working in schools there, and it was a great example of an organisation that's gone on to and the development and the feed through into the arts, people now working in that area was quite profound, so quite timely to have had that last night. Yeah, Donald, do you want to come in?
Convener, so what's common to the last couple of contributions is the importance of working from community base up. And I think there's more cross-budget collaboration and cooperation actually going on that level than we maybe realise. And the central policy making is important to that because there's emphasis on sustainability and community placemaking. And I think that culture's got a big contribution on that level and that is beginning to happen. And that's something we need to see. How can we strategically support that at the kind of more overall budget level? And on a specific within that as well, we do speak, sometimes speak about heritage and culture as being two different things, but at local level, the heritage and the cultural side absolutely belong together. And I know that we've been reviewing, and we as Traditional Arts and Culture Scotland, Historic Environment Scotland are involved in this, have been looking at the whole area of intangible cultural heritage, which is an internationally recognised category, and there's a possibility that the UK might consider joining UNESCO a convention on intangible cultural heritage. And that's just, you're looking at what are the assets of an area in terms of music and story and creative energy and all the rest of it. And we're very rich in that in Scotland. So I think we're back here to this thing. There are huge positives that these kind of cross-budget, cross-organisational working, I believe, is happening and will grow. And therefore, it's back to that positive trajectory that we're not snuffing out something that I think is happening and could happen on a larger and very fruitful scale. And when you do all that, the other critical thing is citizen support. There is huge public support for this kind of community-based and creative working and for creative opportunities for young people. That's a huge, we're not talking about something here that's obscure and narrow and is only supported by a certain set of organisations and corporate bodies. People want this. People want this for their families and their kids for the future.
Okay, I think I'm going to move on to Mr. Golden. Thank you.
Thanks, convener. I just wanted to pick up around the topic of net zero and maybe start with Alex Paterson, because you've mentioned it in respect to some of your previous answers. Clearly, net zero is going to remain a focus. But given the budget settlement and particularly around the capital budget, what progress are you likely to be able to make in this area, particularly around estates and buildings?
I hope quite a lot. I mean, I think I wrote to the committee after we were last here with a range of things we were doing, practical interventions we were doing, ranging from improvements to the estate to waste strategies to responsible tourism initiatives that we want to try and roll out. So we want to continue doing that, and it is a top priority for the organisation that we deliver our climate action plan. I think that one of the things I said the last time, and I'll say it again here because it's very relevant to this, is that achieving the net zero ambitions for Scotland requires things to be done across the historic environment estate. So the whole reuse and retrofit of buildings, making them energy efficiency, making them energy efficient, is vitally important. And again, as I said last time, one of the key contributors to that is skills. We're not going to achieve what we want to achieve as a nation in terms of our net zero aspirations without the skilled people that we need to deliver these sort of things. So my very basic example is We can improve the energy efficiency of historic properties, but if the fabric of them is not right, then you know you're compromising the energy efficiency. So stonemasonry, traditional skills, investing in those is critical. And as again said last time, those things are a real challenge at the moment for the sector. We've taken on the largest apprenticeship intake that I think we've ever taken on this year, but there are challenges around the wider sector around stonemasonry and other traditional skills, and we're doing a bit of work on it just now with a view to trying to find a sustainable future. So various aspects or dimensions to my answer. We as an organisation are hugely committed to the net zero agenda as it manifests itself in various ways on the estate, where we can make investments that deliver that, we will do it. The most recent one was solar panels at Edinburgh Castle, but our team are working on other interventions across the country. But beyond that, how do we, back to the mainstreaming point, how do we get the message out there that reuse and retrofitting of historic properties with the right skilled tradesmen to do the work and improving energy efficiency, that's a huge contribution to the national aspirations for net zero.
Thanks. Sir John, did you want to come in on this as well?
Thank you. Yes. Well, like Historic Environment Scotland, we're also completely and hugely committed to the path to net zero. And as the guardian of five Grade A historic buildings, we have still some work to do to make those as energy efficient as possible. So, and I think I touched on this at the last hearing, I think the three things that would be part of our planning would be what we do within our own infrastructure and estates and how we make that as efficient as possible. What we have to do, secondly, then to protect the collection in the future from the effects of climate change, which we're already seeing quite dramatically, and how we operate as an organisation to minimise our impact on the environment, thinking about travel, international loans and so on. And a project related to that, which is very important to us, is the project to create a new collections facility in North Edinburgh, which would do away with the need for a number of really inefficient stores, but create a new hub built to Passive House standards that would allow us to look after the collection properly, but also to distribute it both locally, nationally and internationally in efficient ways. And then a third strand, which I think is also incredibly important, is how we, in our programming, introduce and raise awareness of issues relating to climate change. And I think I used the phrase the last time that artists are, in some ways, the canaries in the coal mine of society. And many artists, particularly contemporary artists, feel extremely strongly, are very engaged with issues to do with climate change. And providing a platform for them, I think, helps generally in the whole construction of arguments and raising awareness across society about the urgency for action. So there's, in short, some of the key factors of our planning ahead. Thank you.
Thanks. That's very useful. I don't know. Chris?
I just want to raise one thing, which is that whilst there is a massive commitment in the grassroots music sector to doing that, and many operators are doing things in the ways that they can, say, about recycling and around uses of materials, the biggest challenge that we have is ownership of the infrastructure. As I mentioned earlier, 93% of the venues are not owned by the people that operate them or are owned by just commercial landlords. And so the challenge there is that they're not able to make changes, whether or not they want to put better insulation in or improve their supply or even add solar panels or look at other energy challenges. They do not have the opportunity to do that, and it's something that is very much aimed just at the grassroots music sector, because they say, I think one of the biggest challenges here is that not everything works for all areas of culture, because we have slightly different operations to other areas, and that's why we say we're looking at support for being able to purchase those spaces, and we're not looking at the fact that we're looking at investment, we're not looking at kind of overall just purchases of all and safeguarding of all these venues. We are looking at being done a responsible community-led way, and so I think further support for that, whether it's through actual funds or through helping with the mechanism of being able to move these venues from commercial ownership into a more community-based scheme would be much better. One of the challenges we're seeing around that, we've had previously work around asset of community value, which has had some success, but in general, honestly, it's not very easy to implement. One thing that would be good to look at in the future is being able to look at compulsory purchasing and ways in which that we can recognise these cultural sites, because one of the biggest challenges we find is that venues last for 5-10 years and then are lost. And for many of these spaces, it's very difficult to find spaces that are suitable for performances like this. So we are really concerned that once we lose these venues, we won't be able to replicate them. We haven't seen a new grassroots music venue being built for many a year. So it's quite important that we look at that. And it allows then these venues, who are very much driven to make these changes to carbon neutral, to be able to look at that. So that's one of the biggest challenges we find at the moment.
Thanks for that. Yes.
So just to say on a practical point, a lot of arts venues in Scotland are not energy efficient and need investment to get up to the whole carbon reduction agenda. If you take money out of the arts lottery funds to prop up revenue funds to keep for organisational grants, you're actually depleting what is probably one of the key potential sources for investment in improving the arts infrastructure environmentally.
Okay, thanks. Yes.
Last June, I took a group of artists to the SCVO's annual gathering. We took three artists to meet, I think it was about 50 charitable organisations who were working in the area of carbon reduction and net zero. Those three artists demonstrated to the potential partners just the way that they're leading the conversation. We had artists who were working on articulating the amazing resource that we have in Scotland's own rainforest in Argyll. We had a curator from Oban who was talking about the imperative in a kind of the beautiful landscape of Oban. It's quite often difficult to understand and articulate the climate crisis. It seems it's damp, it's beautiful, it's green. How do you articulate those issues? And so the curator there was building a coalition of local organisations to have that conversation. And then we had an internationally renowned artist, Robin Wilson, who was talking about the work that she was doing. For example, she's based in the Highlands, but she was working in Texas, talking about the oil economy and showing a major exhibition at the University of Texas. So artists are really leading those conversations. Investment in artists is investment in that. Canary in the coal mine is exactly the phrase that I was going to use. So Sir John got there first. So that's really critical. For members who are organisations, many of them are working in found buildings, you know, in historic spaces, in heritage buildings. Talked about people working in town centres, for example, where they're taking over buildings that have fallen out of use. Those organisations are desperate for support for carbon adaptation. Part of the conditions of funding from Creative Scotland are that organisations are carbon monitoring, they're committed to carbon reduction. You know, every year we fill in a form to say how much we're reducing our waste. We're doing this work, but it is going to require support around buildings. And that doesn't, it's not reaching us. There are no clear mechanisms for us. Artists themselves and organisations generally lead low carbon lifestyles. I'm often saying that one of the ways that you can really support artists is through, for example, active and sustainable travel. I work in a building where we've invested, the landlord, Wasps, has invested in cycling facilities. We can do it and we are doing it. The culture is at the kind of vanguard of this conversation, but desperately needs the support around capital adaptation.
Thanks for that. Yes, Ian, would you like to come in?
Thank you. I mean, it's just reinforce a few points, and if I may, I mean, Creative Scotland and the sector is very committed to this agenda in the way that you've just been hearing about. Last year, we published our climate emergency and sustainability plan, which is
drawing on 10 years' worth of work that we've been doing, where we've kind of picked all the low-hanging fruit, and is intended to now move us on, because the strength of feeling around this agenda is very strong, like I say, in terms of the commitment that we in the sector have got. In that plan, there's a combination of things that we'll be doing, some of which is about how we can look at carbon budgets, how we can look at funding criteria, how we can look at practical support. But the adaptation point is a critical one within it, and it's very under-resourced at the moment, and will be key to achieving that path to net zero for the cultural sector. I think, in summary, for us, this has three layers to it. There's what we do as an organisation in our own carbon management and climate sustainability. There's what we then can translate into the second layer, which is the organisations and the people that we support in the work that they do and how they do it. And the third is an important one to recognise, which is the work of those artists, the work of those cultural organisations, go on then through the work that they do to inspire and influence and inform and change behaviours around this whole agenda. So there's a kind of ripple effect there about taking care of the kind of hard nuts and bolts, but the kind of softer dimension to it, which is about how it informs and influences public opinion and behaviours, is a really important one to not lose sight of. And yet again, we'll need investment to be able to achieve that.
Thanks for that. Back to you, convener.
Thank you. Ms Boyack.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, I think this has been an excellent discussion. I took out of our last session, the round table, the phrase, the perfect storm and the challenge of keeping the doors open and the lights on. Today, I'm taking culture and heritage as in our DNA, but we need to avoid the culture of doom. Is there a need for us to have rescue plans for organisations, given the cuts that you've been talking about from the very start of today, to keep organisations viable? Because I give the example of Film House. Nobody saw that coming. Came as a total shock. So the organisation totally went into administration. No space for a potential rescue plan. There's still discussions, but the minute you're in administration, that's a very different trajectory. And it's much easier to save a project than deal with the wider negative impacts of loss, because everybody's talked about the benefits of culture. So is there something we need to do in terms of a crisis plan so that you can get that wider cross-government support? Because in the Film House, you potentially lose two cinemas, massive impact on the film festival in Edinburgh, International Film Festival, jobs, economy, culture, education. So it's that, you know, we deal with crisis, but here we're potentially walking into crisis. Is there something we need to do now to ask for government support coming out of cuts? You either sort the cuts, but from what you've talked about earlier, particularly in the opening contributions, we're moving into a very difficult position for many, many organisations right across Scotland. Ian? I'm looking at Ian, because we started off with you, and you've got the big cuts coming up.
Indeed, and I'll go back to a couple of points that I made initially on this. Yeah, I think this is born out of systemic underinvestment in the sector for many, many years. And we're now about to go beyond the tipping point. And when things are gone, they're gone, like you've said. And it's very hard to recover from that. So much better to take a strategic approach that seeks to manage that with everybody involved, whatever the budget situation. But actually, as we've noted before, for just a little bit more, you could reverse the prospects and fortunes of all that we've been talking about here that is by way of negative outcomes. Because actually the positive contribution that the sector makes is enormous, and it's understood. We need to unlock that opportunity. So I think our ability to navigate this has now been severely curtailed by us having to use national lottery reserves to offset the cut, because those national lottery reserves were going to be part of us helping to manage that strategic context to a different outcome than the one that I think we're currently facing. So having used them for the cuts, it's no longer available to be used for those purposes. And actually, where do we afford it from? I think people are at risk in the immediate short term, and we have no financial flexibility. There are no financial safety nets in place to be able to address those potential outcomes. So I suppose that's why I said at the outset I'm very concerned about the short, the medium and the long-term future here. I don't think this is at all about a recovery agenda. This is about survival. And the energy and focus from, as I mentioned earlier, an already exhausted sector, being turning their attention to survival is energy that is not being channeled into creative output and creative work that delivers all the positive benefits and value that we know. So I am struggling at the moment to see beyond trying to bring people together for practical conversations how we can actually oil the wheels of change that is going to be necessary to understand how we can take ourselves towards a more confident future and take control of that rather than let it happen by default.
I mean, there's 11 months until there'll be a new Scottish budget. So I support Sarah Boyett's point that I think that Creative Scotland needs to lead on coming up with some kind of rescue plan for the arts sector, which takes into account the difficulties that are being faced, the severe risks that are being faced. But perhaps we have just that window of 10, 11 months to get a handle on the specifics of this and to present a case to the next, because, you know, the interim period is where we're at. But I think we have to use this time to try and look forward in a tough but hopeful that we can take a core base through this next very difficult period and make sure that all the positives we've discussed are held on to. So I hope that this committee would not go away from the meeting on the presumption there's nothing to be done. I think we have to get our sleeves rolled up to get an exact dimension on this and see what the potential for getting through it and potentially shifting the dial is, you know. I think that was maybe what was behind Sarah Boyett's question. I'm not sure.
This is about money, but it's clearly also about strategic leadership. Our organisations, our artists are hitting all the aspirations of the cultural strategy. They're working doubly hard under challenging circumstances. And at the moment, it feels that they're operating in a strategic vacuum. There's a lack of clarity about who would be saved, why they would be saved, because they're meeting all of these outcomes across the performance framework, and they're performing extraordinarily well under really difficult circumstances. There needs to be a plan, and there needs to be a clear sense of strategic vision for the future.
I think one of the key things that Sarah mentioned there was when she said that nobody saw that coming for that particular organisation. And that's one of the challenges that we have really identified, is that particularly with a lot of our organisations being commercial and not charities and not having reserves in place, is that they need to have a support structure to be able to tell people that they're in trouble. And one of the major issues that we've had as a charity, which has just become registered in Scotland, is that we have been unable to support a lot of members because of the fact that we are unable to get funding for coordinators to be representatives of these venues and be able to talk to it. One of the reasons why I am here today, rather than having a Scottish coordinator from our charity, is because we currently are not able to put that in place. And I think that's one of the key things, is we need to be able to support organisations to also bring up what is going on at the grassroots level and any of these arts organisations to be able to bring that to governments. And that's one thing that it doesn't take a lot of investment to do that. One of the key issues that we have there is that we, again, unfortunately, Scotland, compared to the other nations in the UK, is not able to be represented We have coordinators for England, we have them in place, Wales have had, and that is just mainly down to funding. And that's not just, again, I'm not looking just at government, but also investment from other areas and investment from the sector. And I think that is key and important. One of the, I've mentioned previously that, you know, it's also for these venues and for these organisations is being able to say, look, what can we not pay at the moment? You know, they're very aware they're in a tough situation. How can we reduce those costs down? I mentioned earlier that they say a bit about the business rates, and that is our major challenge because it's something that is just for our sector compared to the rest of culture, really, due to the way that a lot of our organisations are done. But the cost of that, and in order to make that £1 million back, is in ticket prices going to be £5 million because of the fact that in order to make that money back, we have other costs. If we were to make it back from hospitality sales and from retail sales, it would be £3.5 million, whereas actually it's just easy to say, well, don't pay that £1 million. And whether that's done at a national level or whether it's support that's given to local authorities, we mentioned earlier that local authorities are key to culture in their areas and they know exactly what's going on, give them more discretionary powers to be able to say, well, look, okay, we understand that you're not able to afford this cost at this point in time, but you will be able to next year, so let's not pay that for the moment. Being able to give more discretionary powers to authorities as well is key to that. Because they'll be able to identify. We're aware that some venues can afford to pay these things. Some venues are in decent situations. And I think there needs to be more discretionary power given to local authorities around that and being able to offer relief against some of those costs. It's not just about funding and giving out money to public funding. It's about also making it easier for organisations to not have to pay as much for the other things as well. So, yeah, and I do think there needs to be more interaction so that we do know in advance. And one of the key things, I think a lot of organisations at the moment are so busy fighting fires that they don't have time to ask for help. I mentioned the fund that we set up. It's £5,000 in money to venues, which is it's a 12-question application form. I would have thought that every venue in the country would be biting our hands off to get some money. And yet we're still finding that venues are struggling to find the time because they're too busy fighting fires. And so we want to give people as well time. And that happens through creative networks where people are supported to actually realise that instead of just dealing with the day-to-day of what's going on, that they need to focus on the future and they need to be given that time and the opportunity to do that. So we hope that will happen.
I think that may have exhausted questions and contributions for today. Can I thank everyone? It's been a really important and really interesting, as Sarah has said, really important session to have had prior to the budget. And next week we will have the Cabinet Secretary in front of us on the budget, and also the Swedish ambassador is coming on the priorities of the presidency of the Council of the EU going forward. And on that note, I'll close this meeting.